to kick off the last block of today. And I have the great pleasure to introduce to you Per Minborg from Oracle.
Thank you for the introduction. So I'm here to tell you a little bit more about Project Panama and the foreign function and memory API. I work at the core libraries team at Oracle. I work at Oracle. So that's that. What is Panama? Panama consists basically of two main parts. One is the foreign function and API, which I'm going to talk about today. And the other part is the vector API, which I'm not going to talk about today. Maybe another time. So Panama provides access to various native libraries. And we've seen a huge amount of native libraries in the past years, for example, for off-CPU computing, deep learning, graphics card, and other sort of useful libraries. And we're not going to expect these to be written in Java anytime soon, but perhaps never. But they don't need to be written in Java anymore, because with Panama, we can access these libraries very conveniently. Another objective of Panama is to make things faster. So with JNI, for example, that we used intensely within the JDK itself, it's not that quick. But if we use Panama, we can improve speed. And if we use tweaks, special tweaks with Panama, it can be even quicker. And in fact, the other day, we introduced a new linker option that made it even faster. That's going to debut in 21, or maybe 20 even. So I have some demos here. So without further ado, let's switch to the IDE. I only have 13 minutes, so let's start cracking. So let's see, we have a C struct here, for example. I use C examples here, but nothing prevents us from interfacing with other languages as well. But most of the libraries are written in C. So here I have the old familiar point2D here with the double X, with the double Y, and I declare a point at this coordinate here, 3, 4. So how can I model that in Panama? I use something called a memory segment. And a memory segment is an abstraction of a continuous region of 64-bit memory. But it contains more than that. It contains spatial, temporal, and thread confinement guarantees. And with spatial, I mean it has some kind of extension, so it has a certain length. In this example, we have a length of 16 bytes, so I'm not able to access this memory outside that without raising an exception. With temporal, I mean that this memory segment has a certain lifetime. So if I close this memory segment, I won't be able to access that without raising an exception. I will never get a JVM crash, for example, as that's a stark contrast to other languages. Who of you have coded in C or C++? And of all who rose your hand, who has never accessed it out of a memory pointer? There are no liars here. That's good. That's great. So here I have this memory segment. I set the value, a double value at this offset, and I set the value 3. Then I set another double value at offset 8, and with another value of 4. As you might think at this time, this sucks a bit. So we will see in example 6 how we can do this in a better way. But this is the kind of basic principle. There are also some interoperability things that you can interoperate with arrays or byte buffers. For example, I want to create a copy of this point here and view it as a byte buffer, not a byte buffer, but byte array or a double array. Or I can present the view as a byte buffer. And then I can print those arrays out, just like I can do with normal arrays. And there is also interoperability in the other direction. So if I have an array, I can create a view as a memory segment or a view as a segment of a byte buffer. Now, the reason I have to make a copy here and all the others are a view is that an array is always on heap. So there is no way to express an array that is off heap, at least not yet. So I'm going to run this and see what happens. And hopefully I'm more successful than Jose was this day. So it actually worked. That's great. So, and I'm going to make this a bit larger so you can see. So here is the byte array view of this. This, of course, doesn't make any sense unless you know by heart how doubles are encoded binary. Most people don't. But this looks more familiar. So we have a 3, 4 here. And this is a direct byte buffer because my memory segment was off heat, so it's going to be in a direct byte buffer abstraction. So that's great, but there is more to it. So the previous example was kind of around malloc and free, but I can also use a memory segment around the concept of mapping and unmapping. So here I have set up a file channel, and then I can map my memory segment onto that file. And here I'm kind of ambitious. I'm trying to map a 64 terabyte memory segment on my M1 Mac here. So what is the opinion? Is it going to crash? Some people, I thought it's going to crash. Is it going to succeed? No one knows actually, so let's run it and see what happens. Well, it didn't crash. Success, so that really shows the power of the Panama API. So I created this huge file here, and I can go in the file system and see that I actually have this huge file here. Now, in reality, it doesn't occupy 64 terabytes, obviously, because then my laptop will be hovering around here somewhere. But I can show you here. Let's see here. So the actual use is actually zero because I didn't use any memory. So it's only when I'm using memory that memory is actually allocated from this. And that's great when you want to try things out. Another good thing is that this file will remain after my JVM exits. I still have my file there for post-mortal inspection. So let's remove this one here. So that's cool. Let's go over to another concept, which is called an arena. Now, arenas are actually the star of the Panama API, I would say. An arena is used to kind of slice off memory segments from. So here I create an arena, a note I use here in a try with resources clause. So I can carve out my memory segment here. In this example, it's 16 bytes. I do stuff with this. This is exactly the same as I did in the previous example. And when I reach the end of this block here, the arena will be atomically closed, and every memory segment carved out will be made invalid. So maybe if I have 16 bytes, it doesn't matter, but maybe if I have a terabyte, it does actually matter because that will consume a lot of internal resources in my code, in my program. And also point is not accessible here semantically. Now, as you see here, I say that I want an arena that is confined. That means that it can only be accessed by that particular thread, and that makes certain optimizations possible under the hood. But I can also say that I want something called a shared arena, which can allow any thread to share resources that have been carved out from this arena. And the cool thing now is that when this exits this block, I'm not able to crash the JVM either. Even though I might be trying to free it in another thread, the JVM will be able to handle this in a good way. So that is safe, and that is one of the objectives with the the foreign memory function API, that it should be safe as opposed to other languages. And that also makes it much harder than you might imagine from the beginning. So now we can go about and use the knowledge we have from the different examples here and set together something I call an infinite arena. Now, an infinite arena allows you to create almost an unlimited amount of memory. So you can just allocate terabyte after terabyte of this arena. And of course, I'm not using regular memory, I'm using file mapping here. So I create a file channel and I carve out the amount of memory. There are some things that are not really for real here, but it's easy to modify this to be strictly correct. And so I can use this in my code. So I first carve out the terabyte. I don't do anything with that. I carve out another terabyte, and I view this arena as a slice here, starting from 1K and 256 bytes upwards. And I fill that with the contents of 2. And then I allocate another segment here, and then I put a string there with all familiar hello world. And then everything is unmapped, but it's unmapped, so I can't access this, but the files will still remain. So let's run this and see what happens. I only have 6 minutes left, so I better hurry up. Okay, so here we are. Let's see what we have in the file system. So we have this called infinite arena 0, 1, 2. Now, I made a very simple implementation. So you have an atomic counter that increases for every allocation. But of course, you can implement that in any way you want. So let's check here what goes on. So you can see that the one we didn't touch was 0 bytes. The other one was 16K that we partially filled. And this one was 4K with just hello world, because presumably it's operating on a block level. And I think the block level is 4K in this machine. So let's take a closer look. Let's, for example, use hex dump. And let's check the first guy here. What happens? It's just a bunch of zeros, because that's the definition. It's initialized by zero. And in reality, all the bytes doesn't exist on the disk. And here's another example. Everything is zero until we reach this 1K. Then everything is 2 until we reach 256 bytes over that, and then everything is zero. And let's take a closer look at the last one. So here we see hello world. So that's cool. That's how we interact with memory. And we need to do that in order to call native functions. Let's see. There is another way to structure access. I'm going to hurry up now. But as you can see, there's a structure called point double X double Y. And you can do the same now in Java. You can say that they have a struct here, the double X with the double Y. And then I can get an accessor for X and for an accessor for Y by just mentioning that I want one for X and I want one for Y here. And then I can just use them. So I allocate something with this struct. I don't need to know the actual size of it. Will the FFM figure out by itself. And then I set the X and then I set the Y. So this is a bit nicer. And here's something we are considering adding in. So we can inspect a memory segment using a layout. And for every line I get there, hopefully I get something that's similar to this. So let's run this, and I will make this bigger so you can see. Oh. So here we have a layout. It's a double with 64 bits called X, a double with 64 bits called Y. Can you see this? It's a bit. I'll try to make it bigger. And the layout is 16, unsurprisingly, that sounds good. And this is kind of the inspector. So there's a 0.2D with X, 3, Y, 4. And also I showed an atomic operation later down here, compare and set. So the accessors here are not only getters and setters, that are a lot of candy you can use there to do really cool things. Now, of course, we don't want to use this, so you can wrap this into a regular Java class. I won't show this today, but it's, I would say, almost trivial to create a class that encapsulates a segment and apply those accessors that we can get from them. And now everything looks like regular Java, but it's using the FFM under the hood. So this looks like a regular Java object. And now we're going to see, okay, there you can do the same for an array. So let's look at calling a native C function. So here is a struct for the time library. Maybe you have seen this before. We have seconds, minutes, hours, days, and all that stuff. And then I model this using the memory layout like that struct. And I just say I have a C int, which is called this. I have another C int, which is called that, and so on. And then there is also a library call called askTime, where I provide a pointer to such a structure we just spoke about, and that will return another pointer. So I made this little small utility method here. This is really just a few lines of code, and it will locate my native method, and here is the signature of that method. This is the return type. It's an address for which I don't know the length, and there is also an address for which I do know the length, because that can be derived from the structure I have. And then I use the arena, and usually, as I did in the other examples, I carve out a memory segment like this with this structure here. I set the values, and then I just invoke this method. And note that there is no trampoline or no intermediate C code here. Everything is Java. So that is really nice. Of course, because I get the C struct, there is a utility method that can convert it to a Java string here, and then I hopefully will print something like this. If I timed my presentation right, this time will coincide with the actual time right now. So let's run this, and hooray, it worked. So there we have it, 1545, maybe it's a little bit off. A few minutes after the schedule. And that's cool, and you can use this already today. It's a preview feature. If you go to Java, you can download a preview of Java 20. And that completes my presentation. So, thank you, everybody.